quails still migrate across that region, and in the evening they can be still caught by hand. And quail tastes very nice, by the way. It's still a delicacy in Egypt. And in fact, just by coincidence, I had grilled quail last night, and it's very nice. It was on the menu. We went out to our anniversary yesterday, went out a meal last night, and saw quail, grilled quail on the menu, and I thought, I'm speaking on that tomorrow. I can't resist that. So we had, Leslie and I, we had quail, among other things, last night. Very nice.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspiring biblical teaching and other excellent Christian videos. You can order the teaching video DVDs, listen to and study the audio versions of these, or download them as audio podcasts to your computer or MP3 player. Today's inspiring and biblical teaching is called Bread from Heaven, Exodus chapter 15 verses 22 to 16 verse 36, by Pastor David Wise.
This morning we're resuming a series that we took a break from probably nearly 2 months ago now. We're going back into the book of Exodus. So if you'd like to turn to Exodus chapter 15. Exodus is probably the most significant book in the Old Testament. It is foundational to everything that follows in the Old Testament. And in many ways, it's the Old Testament equivalent of the Gospels. It's also foundational to a lot of stuff that is in the New Testament, that leads back. We're going to look right at the end this morning, just of some things that Jesus said about himself that come right back out of the story in the Old Testament we're going to look at today. Some parts of this story are really well known. I mean, the plagues that came on the Egyptians, the Passover, the crossing of the Red Sea, really well-known stories. But many Christians simply do not understand the significance of these stories for themselves today. So as we work through, we're going to be looking very carefully at that. Now, if you've recently started coming to the church, as I know some of you have, or maybe you're a visitor here and you think, actually, I'd like to find out a bit more about that, on our church website, gbc.org.uk, you will find all the previous parts of this series are all there under the teaching for 2008. You can watch it. It's quality, video recording, good sound, and it's there for you to either to download or to watch on the website. Or you can just download it to an iPod and you can listen to it as well. You don't have to watch it. If you've had enough of seeing me this morning, if you don't want to see him again, just listen, then that's there as well. So I want to begin this morning just with a little bit of a recap, just to where we've got to in the story, particularly for the benefit of people who are hearing this for the first time. Exodus opens with the people of Israel in Egypt. Now, they were in Egypt because God had led them there. They weren't in Egypt because they were in sin, but they were in Egypt because God had left them there. But they're in a difficult situation. They are slaves. The Egyptians have put them to forced labor. And in fact, there is a process of genocide that is going on. The Egyptians have decided that the people of God are becoming too numerous and too powerful. So they introduce a policy that sees every male that is born killed at birth. Doesn't work terribly well. God finds ways around it. And the people are crying out to God, and so God sends them Moses. The way that his life is preserved is miraculous. He's brought up in the court of Pharaoh. He's given all the privileges of Egypt, and yet he is a Hebrew, later known as the Jews. Moses is man's God, is God's man for the hour, but Moses messes up big time. He loses his temper one day, and he kills somebody. And he then has to run off, and he hides 40 years in the desert, looking after some animals for somebody else. And then one day, God appears to him in a burning bush and says, Moses, It's time to go back. And so Moses ends up going back to Egypt, back to do what God, the ministry that God had prepared for him to do. But it doesn't go well. It doesn't go well at all. In fact, for every step forward he takes, the people of God seem to end up taking two steps backwards. Until finally, they are released. In fact, they're expelled from Egypt. There is all these series of plagues, finishing with the death of the firstborn, same time of the Passover. And they leave Egypt, and God takes them across the Red Sea. And, you know, it's a well-known story, made into a film. You know, they cross the sea, all the sea stacked up in great big piles on either side, and they go across the middle, and all the Egyptians follow in behind them, and all the water falls on them. And when they get to the other side, they have a party. Oi, do they celebrate? They worship God, they sing, they get so excited because God has set them free. And where we pick up the story today is 3 days later, 3 days after that big celebration. 1 Corinthians 10, which we're not going to read, it talks about this part of the story. And it says, these things were written for us. There's an awful lot we can learn this morning. This story happened thousands of years ago, but God is the same. Human beings are the same. I've already used this story in praying for somebody this morning because it is so relevant to our lives, our situations, our circumstances today. So as we go through here, expect God to be speaking into your life for today. Because I believe that God wants to speak to every single one of us who are here in the room this morning. And if you're watching this on the internet, God wants to speak to you today. God's word for you. Not just a bit of teaching. Not just an old story. But for God to speak into your life today. So let's look. We begin at verse 22 of Exodus chapter 15. I should explain, by the way, if you're a visitor here, that occasionally as I go through, I'm going to stop and ask questions. And when I stop and ask the question, that's an opportunity for you to help with the answer. Okay, so these aren't just rhetorical questions. We're going to discuss together bits of this. We go through. Hope that's okay. We're going to do it whether it's okay or not, but I hope it's okay. So we'll have some dialogue together. So Exodus chapter 15, beginning at verse 22. Then Moses, it's just at the end of the celebration, just finished. They just sung the last verse. Then Moses led Israel from the Red Sea, and they went into the desert of Shur. For 3 days they travelled in the desert without finding water. And when they came to Marah, they could not drink its water because it was bitter. That's why the place is called Marah, which means bitter. So the people grumbled against Moses, saying, "What are we to drink?" So these people moved straight from a great celebration, straight from dancing, and they were dancing with their timbrels and tambourines and whirling about and thanking God and celebrating God and all of that. They've just seen amazing miracles. They've just seen all the firstborn males in Israel, in Egypt, slain. They've seen themselves released from Egypt. They've just crossed through the Dead Sea. All the water stacked on one side, all the water stacked on the other side. They've gone through the middle. God's closed it on his enemies. 3 days later, 72 hours later, they're grumbling. What are we going to drink? And they're grumbling against Moses. But it isn't actually Moses they're grumbling against, of course. I mean, Moses happens to be the leader. But sometimes when people complain about leaders, I'm sorry, actually it's God they're complaining about. And here, this wasn't Moses' fault. Moses was doing what God had asked him to do. But in the people's defense, I want you just to imagine this situation. Okay, they're in the desert. They would have had water with them, of course. They would have taken some food with them. They would have taken water with them. I mean, you know, you're traveling in the desert, you take some water with you. I mean, that's, you know. 3 days, they are running a bit short of water, and they see an oasis. excellent. So they assume this is God's provision, which it is, but... So they all go towards this oasis, and they get some of this water, and they pick it up, and they drink it, and it doesn't taste very nice. It's bitter. Now, I want you just to notice that for them, this is a bitter disappointment. It's a bitter disappointment. But you know, bitter disappointments are a part of life. Hello? Bitter disappointments are a part of life. We live in a broken world. We live in a world that is in rebellion against God. And bitter disappointments are a part of life. They're not in the wrong place. They're not in sin. They're not in rebellion against God. Well, at least not on this occasion. They're in the right place at the right time, but they're disappointed. Bitter disappointments are a part of life, but they're no excuse for grumbling against God. Because the promise in Romans, the promise from God, is that God will turn all things to good for those who love him. In Chantel and Mason's testimony this morning, in Chantel's life came the most horrendous, bitter disappointment. I'm not going to add to anything she told you in the story this morning. Some of you know in even more detail. Incredible, bitter disappointment. She wouldn't have chosen to go that route in life. I tell you, nobody does. But God has taken hold of that. God has worked in the situation in a most amazing, miraculous way. And out of that has brought sweetness in that family, out of bitterness. Moses cried out to the Lord, verse 25, and the Lord showed him a piece of wood. He threw it into the water, and the water became sweet. Therefore the Lord made a decree and a law for them, and he tested them there. He said, if you listen carefully to the voice of the Lord your God and do what is right in his eyes, if you pay attention to his commands and keep all his decrees, I will not bring on you any of the diseases I brought on the Egyptians, for I am the Lord who heals you. And then they came to Elim, where there were 12 springs and 70 palm trees, and they camped there near the water. Moses found a piece of wood. It might have been a whole tree, actually. The word can mean either. It perhaps was an aromatic shrub. It's something which still today is used. Some of the water in this area, it's bitter, caused by natural minerals that are in the water. And you take some of this aromatic shrub and you put it in the water, and the flavour of the shrub covers the bitterness in the water and makes it drinkable and pleasant. It's amazing, you know, God's provision for us. I wonder how long ago God decided that tree was going to grow there. Thinking, one day my people are going to be coming this way. And they're going to need water. And this water here is not very nice. And so I'm going to show them my abundant, amazing, indescribable, incomparable provision. I'm going to put a tree there for them so they can drink this water. How many years before, in their need, God had made provision? Like for us. For Chantel and Mason, just going back to their situation, in that situation of need for them, for both of them in their different contexts, God had set in place provision for them. In fact, I'm not going to tell you the story, but if you ever sit and listen to some of Mason's story and discover some of the amazing God incidences that just happened in his life. Extraordinary things, people just being in the right place at the right time and saying the right thing that spoke into his situation, spoke into his need. God had it all planned out. And God has that for you. You see, God knows all about your life. Every detail, every aspect, all the twists and turns. He knows where you're going to mess up. And he knows how he's going to bring you back to him. And in it all, there's God's provision. It's amazing. God's trees are there for you. To take hold of those bitter things and to make them sweet. Notice how God's provision actually came for them out of human obedience. God could have just gone zap out of heaven and just changed the water, you know. Could have turned it into wine after all. No? God could have done what he liked. But he's put something there where someone who is a human being in following God has to do something. They have to take this tree and they have to put this in the water. See, because God chooses to work through us. I mean, God does do things that are just supernatural, that are, you know, in the zap category. But a lot of the time, God chooses to work through us. He says, would you do this? You do that. The people that came Mason's way, they were obedient to God. They said the things that God gave them to say. Some outrageous things, actually, at times. But God does it. God does it. The provision is there. God works there. And it says here, he tested them. Now, that sounds a strange thing. He tested them. You know, it's how we respond in these bitter places when life does not make sense that actually reveals our heart. It shows what really is going on the inside. It reveals our faith. Let me read to you some words from 1 John. It's from 1 John chapter 2, just a couple of verses, verse 3 down to verse 5. We know that we have come to know him if we obey his commands. The man who says, I know him, but does not do what he commands is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But if anyone obeys his word, God's love is truly made complete in him. This is how we know we are in him. Faith cannot be known to be true until it is tested. So let's think about this story for a moment before we move on to chapter 16. What can we learn for us today, 2008, living as we are in West London? What can we take from this story? What can we learn from this story for us today? This is a real question, not a rhetorical question. Jo.
Why is it important, if you're in a difficult situation, to cry to God? Because if you don't, you won't see the answer.
Okay, so in difficult situations, it's really important that we cry out to God, that we talk to God. Yeah, very good. Wayne.
God always will make provisions for us, whatever the situation we find ourselves in.
Yeah, God will always make provision for us, whatever the situation we find ourselves in. God's got it planned because God knows what we need. And God does that. Whatever we need. I just, as I was walking past Caleb, I just felt God say to me this morning, as I was just walking down here, that for you specifically today, I mean, you identify with some of this story, but for you, I just feel God wants to say to you specifically today, his provision is there for you. I don't know quite what's going on in your life at the moment. I've got no idea, but the provision is there because God understands. God knows the journey. God knows where you're going, and the provision is there. The tree is there. The tree is there. Whatever it is, the tree is there. as he will pray for you later on. What else coming out of this story? Yeah.
Quite a lot of times when we're going through the Exodus series, again, I'm reminded of the crucifixion. The water, the word goes in the water. Mm-hmm. Obviously, the cross was made of wood. So yep. Again, I'm reminded of everything to do with the crucifixion.
It's very interesting that because...
3 days.
Yeah. A lot of medieval commentators, people writing on this in the Middle Ages, they actually made that point. They saw this as being a symbol of the crucifixion, of Jesus dying on the cross and the cross making people's lives bitter into sweet. And they actually drew that parallel from here with the 3 days and everything else.
It's more bitter than blood on a tree pouring down. It's just a really horrible image
yeah.
to have. And yet we have freedom because of that.
Mm.
I haven't been a Christian for as long as I have. It's like, yeah, every time I screw up, I'm pretty soon back to the cross to try and sort things out.
Okay, so it is that bitterness of the cross that actually makes life sweet for us. He took our hell so we might experience his heaven, to use a different thing. Yeah, okay. Anything else? Joan?
Just that it's normal in the Christian life to be tested.
Yeah, testing in the Christian life is normal. It's normal. It's not because we're in sin, not because we're doing anything wrong. Yeah.
Sometimes when we're in difficulties, we tend to rely on our own strength.
Mm.
And that's wrong. But to go to God is difficult for some reason.
Yeah, so when we're in difficulties, we tend to go on our own strength. Remember going back to the testimony from Mason this morning. He said how he relied on himself. He went inside himself, and what a big mistake that was. Instead of turning to God and seeing what provision he's made for us. Lots of stuff coming out of that. Came across a quote this week, just before we move on to chapter 16, which I want to read to you. It's from a guy called Alec Motyer. He says this: faced with life's problems, we frequently say we have no answers. The Bible, however, is full of answers. The only difficulty is that they're not the sort of answers that we want. And the point that he's making is this, that sometimes when difficult things come our way, we want answers that explain why something is happening. Why is this going on? Why is this happening to that person? Why is this happening to me? What have I done to deserve this? God doesn't answer that question very often. What he says is, trust me. That's the answer, trust me. I'm working out my purposes in your life. Trust me. I'm working my purposes out in your life, says God. Trust me. And that is all the answer that in fact we need. See, we want something that satisfies our curiosity. We want something that sorts out, you know, our natural logical thing of cause and effect. God doesn't work that way. So he doesn't tell us. If he did tell us, we wouldn't understand. My ways aren't your ways, says God. If he did tell us, we wouldn't understand. People say, well, in Genesis chapter 1, why doesn't it tell us more about the way creation was done? Because if God wrote it down, you wouldn't understand it. So the Bible gives us the answers. They're just sometimes not the answers that we want. They're the answers that are best for us, but not the answers that we want. Let's go on to chapter 16. We're going to look at the whole of chapter 16 relatively quickly. The whole Israelite community set out from Elim and came to the desert of Sin, which is between Elim and Sinai, on the 15th day of the second month after they'd come out of Egypt. In the desert, the whole community grumbled against Moses and Aaron. The Israelites said to them, if only we died by the Lord's hand in Egypt. There we sat around pots of meat and ate all the food we wanted. But you have brought us out into this desert to starve this entire community to death. I don't know about you, but there seems to be just a little gap somehow between their memory and what actually happened. Do you notice? Just, you know, they were slaves in Egypt. Do slaves sit around eating all the meat and other food they want? I don't think so. But how human is that, eh? How often do you hear people saying, oh, do you remember when it was like? Thinking, well, actually, I'm not quite sure it was ever quite like that. You know, they look back to some golden age when it was so wonderful compared to now. When I was a child, I remember that. Yeah? Very selective memory, us human beings. And the Israelites here, very selective memory. I mean, the fact that they were on the receiving end of genocide, the fact that they were being made to work so hard, the fact that they spent all that time crying out to God for him to intervene, all of that has gone. And notice what else has come, by the way. Again, enormously human. See, Moses is the leader. What have they done with Moses' motives here? Do you notice what they've done? They assume the worst possible motive. You have the reason, Moses, that you brought us out into the wilderness here is to starve us to death. Hello? Listen. In so many contexts, that is how our brains work. Something happens to us that's not very nice. And we human beings have this amazing tendency of assuming the worst possible motive on the person that's done it. Hello? That is so destructive. It's one of the ways that Satan sometimes gets in, destroys relationships. We just assume. Some time ago, my friend Timmy here, you can stay sitting down, that's okay. My friend Timmy, we fell out. We had a disagreement about, we disagreed quite often, but we had quite a big disagreement. And we disagreed for months. I'm not going to tell you what the disagreement was about, that's between us. But we had a disagreement that went on for months, wasn't it? I mean, I can't remember how many months it was, but 3-4 months. Every time we talked together, just about, we disagreed. I go round his house. We disagree. Come round mine. We disagree. We'd sit in leadership team meetings and this subject would come up and we would disagree for months. But you see, Timmy knew that I wanted the best for him. And I knew that Timmy actually wanted to do, his heart was after doing what God wanted him to do. We just disagreed about it. So we talk about it vigorously. You know, we would shout at one another. Is that fair? Yeah, I'm not exaggerating. I get accused of exaggerating sometimes because I'm a preacher. But we'd shout at one another. But at no point in that did I ever think or say, that Timmy's a really bad person. And no point did Timmy ever think, as far as I know, I'll ask him afterwards, but no point did Timmy ever think, that pastor, he's such a nasty person. How could he be saying that to me? So we were able to work through. That's probably the biggest disagreement we've ever had. We've had others since and before, but that was the biggest we've ever had.
We'll have more.
And no doubt we're going to have more. We haven't finished disagreeing yet. But at no point was our relationship on the line. No point was our relationship threatened, even though we disagreed. Not just for a week, but for months. See, because we didn't start putting false motives into one another. Are you hearing me? We need to be so careful with that. So here they are, just doing that with Moses straight away. Let's follow the rest of the story through. Verse 4. The Lord said to Moses, I will rain down bread from heaven for you. The people are to go out each day and gather enough for that day. In this way I will test them and whether they will and see whether they will follow my instructions. On the sixth day they are to prepare what they bring in, and that is to be twice as much as they gather on the other days. So Moses and Aaron said to all the Israelites, In the evening, you will know that it was the Lord who brought you out of Egypt. In the morning you will see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard of your grumbling against him. Who are we that you should grumble against us? Moses also said, "You will know that it was the Lord when he gives you meat to eat in the evening and all the bread you want in the morning, because he has heard your grumbling against him." Who are we? You're not grumbling against us, but against the Lord. And Moses told Aaron, "Say to the entire Israelite community, come before the Lord, for he has heard your grumbling." When Aaron was speaking to the whole Israelite community, they looked towards the desert, and there was the glory of the Lord appearing in the cloud. Here was a crisis of faith in response to a physical need. The people had quickly forgotten all that God had done for them. I mean, you know, it's not long since they were in Egypt. They'd seen all this miraculous provision. But a spot of hunger meant they forgot all that God had done for them. You know, and in our lives, those of us who are Christians, we've seen God redeem us. We've seen God forgive our sins. We've seen God answer prayers so many times, haven't we? And yet when some difficulty comes along, sometimes it's a crisis. And it's a crisis because we forget what God has done. We forget who God is. And the little thing becomes so big. So God's response was to assure them that he would provide for their daily needs, everything they needed. He would provide. Both the manna and the quail were actually natural foods. The manna, it's still known in the region. It's produced by insects. I won't go into all the details of how it happens, but it's still known in that region. Quails still migrate across that region, and in the evening they can be still caught by hand. And quail tastes very nice, by the way. It's still a delicacy in Egypt. And in fact, just by coincidence, I had grilled quail last night, and it's very nice. It was on the menu. We went out to our anniversary yesterday, went out a meal last night, and saw quail, grilled quail on the menu, and I thought, I'm speaking on that tomorrow. I can't resist that. So we had, Leslie and I, we had quail, among other things, last night. Very nice. They're natural things which God is using to provide, but also there are supernatural elements. And some people will try to explain all this away and say, well, it's just the natural bits that were there to hand. Well, actually, when you look at the number of people there, you look at the regularity of the provision. For 40 years, they ate manna and quails. This is God at work in their situation. Let's follow the story through, verse 12. The Lord said to Moses, "I've heard the grumbling of the Israelites. Tell them at twilight you will eat meat, and in the morning you'll be filled with bread. Then you will know that I am the Lord." That evening, quail came and covered the camp, and in the morning there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the dew was gone, thin flakes like frost on the ground appeared on the desert floor. When the Israelites saw it, they said to each other, "What is it?" For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, "It is the bread the Lord has given you to eat. This is what the Lord has commanded. Each one is to gather as much as he needs. Take an omer for each person you have in your tent." The Israelites did as they were told. Some gathered much, some little. And when they measured it by the omer, he who gathered much did not have too much, and he who gathered little did not have too little. Each one gathered as much as he needed. And Moses said to them, "No one is to keep any of it until morning." However, some of them paid no attention to Moses. They kept part of it until morning, but it was full of maggots and began to smell. So Moses was angry with them. Each morning, everyone gathered as much as he needed, and when the sun grew hot, it melted away. On the sixth day, they gathered twice as much, two omers for each person. And the leaders of the community came and reported this to Moses. He said to them, "This is what the Lord commanded. Tomorrow is to be a day of rest, a holy Sabbath to the Lord. So bake what you want to bake, boil what you want to boil, save whatever is left and keep it until morning." So they saved it until morning, as Moses commanded, and it did not stink or get maggots in it. "Eat it today," Moses said, "because today is a Sabbath to the Lord. You will not find any of it on the ground today. 6 days you are to gather it, but on the seventh day, the Sabbath, there will not be any." Nevertheless, some of the people went out on the seventh day to gather it, but they found none. The Lord said to Moses, "How long Will you refuse to keep my commands and my instructions? Bear in mind that the Lord has given you the Sabbath, and that's why on the sixth day he gives you bread for 2 days. Everyone is to stay where he is on the seventh day. No one is to go out. So the people rested on the seventh day. So what can we learn? What can we learn from this daily supply of manna? What are the lessons for us today? Yeah, Mary.
We've got to just trust God every day, one day at a time. You can't trust him for the next week, like Sunday to Sunday. Mm-hmm. You've got to live every day.
So we trust him every day, God's provision every day. Gives us what we need each day. Yeah, very good. What else? Yeah. Well, sorry, I was looking at the person behind you, Denzel. I'll come back to you.
That God will always provide for our, like, our needs, even though it doesn't seem like it sometimes. That he's there to provide for our needs.
God is there to provide for our needs. Yeah, Denzel, sorry.
Something in here for me about how we deal with the resources we have. I'm thinking particularly of money, but mm-hmm. resources, in terms of what God wants us. He's given it all to us. It's a gift. What he wants us to use today. There are occasions when he's telling us it's right to put something aside for the future. Mm-hmm. But sometimes we can get so preoccupied with saving for the future, and we're not using what God says, use it today, mm-hmm. because the future is going to be in his hand.
There is this balance here, isn't it? Yeah, about what God gives us to use today. Sometimes God gives us stuff to keep.
Yeah.
Sometimes it is for use today, and we need to be listening to God about that. Because what's right one day may not be right, the next day. Yeah. There's something also here that's important about, for me, that I see about Sabbath, the day of rest. You know, we live in a society here in West London that's incredibly busy. We work the longest hours in Europe. I mean, not just in West London, but in the UK. And more pressure to work and work and work. And yet it's very clear, right the way through the Old and New Testament, that part of God's creational design, not just for Christians, but actually for human beings, is the importance of a day of rest. It doesn't have to be a particular day, but that needs to be built in. That is vitally important. And sometimes when I'm talking to people, pastoral visiting, and I find people who are working 7 days a week, remind them. It might be okay for a week, but actually God's plan for you, the way God's made you to work, is to have a day off in seven, a day of rest. Vitally important. Vitally important. It's there. So even in this provision, in the desert, needing extra miraculous stuff, double provision one day, and keeping it so it doesn't go off, it's there. So let's read the rest of this chapter, these last few verses, from verse 31 down to verse 36. The people of Israel called the bread manna. It was white like coriander seed and tasted like wafers made with honey. And Moses said, "This is what the Lord has commanded. Take an omer of manna and keep it for the generations to come, so they can see the bread I gave you to eat in the desert when I brought you out of Egypt." So Moses said to Aaron, "Take a jar and put an omer of manna in it. Then place it before the Lord to be kept for the generations to come." And as the Lord commanded Moses, Aaron put the manna in front of the testimony there that it might be kept. The Israelites ate manna for 40 years until they came to a land that was settled. They ate manna until they reached the border of Canaan. An omer is 1/10 of an ephah. It's hugely significant that something as mundane as manna, daily bread, should be seen as being a stimulus for worship. You know, they didn't build a model of the water either side of the sea that they crossed and put that at the testimony, the place of worship. They didn't paint pictures of dead Egyptians on the ground and have that at the place of worship. What do they have there? Some daily bread. Daily bread. You see, it was to remind them, as it is to remind us, that God provides everything we need every day. Everything we need every day. It's in the mundane, it's in the insignificant stuff of life. All of that is provided by God. A quote this week from someone else I was reading, a guy called Freedom. The seemingly little things in daily life are undergirded by the sustaining care of God. Now, we take so much for granted, don't we? Or particularly in a place like West London where we've got so much. We take so much for granted. I mean, when you had your toast, who had toast for breakfast today? You have toast? Not that popular. What did the rest of you have for breakfast today? Or did you decide, we've got a church lunch today, so we won't eat breakfast? Who had cornflakes? Oh. Two people had cornflakes. Anyway, whatever it was you had for breakfast this morning, I was hoping you all eaten toast, because that would make a really good illustration. Your bagels, croissant, anything like that, you know? Fufu. Fufu. What's fufu? Sorry? Like pounded yam. Oh, I like pounded yam. I don't want pounded yam for breakfast, though. Anyway, whatever it is that you had for breakfast this morning, which probably was just an ordinary thing. You probably didn't have a fantastic special breakfast this morning. It probably was ordinary stuff you had for breakfast, yeah? And you just got it out the cupboard or out of the packet, and you just had it for breakfast, yeah? That ought to be a stimulus to worship the living God for you. Because God provided that. It's God's provision. God's provision for you. But we just take it for granted, don't we? We just think, oh, I'll go to Tesco's and get a bit more. Or wherever it is you happen to go. I mustn't name drop Tesco's, ought to mention Sainsbury's, Asda and Lidl and all the other alternatives. Wherever it is you happen to go. It's God's provision. God's daily provision. God's daily provision. We pray, don't we, when we pray the Lord's Prayer together. Give us each day our daily bread. As I was reading this passage and reading some of the people that are writing on this passage, it chucks some light on some of the questions that sometimes we ask in life when things are difficult. This isn't directly out of the passage here, but I want us to make a little bit on the side here about this, because, again, it's in pastoral stuff. I often hear two explanations that people give, Christians give, when they're experiencing difficulties, to explain difficulties they're facing. And in my experience as a pastor, both these answers are more often wrong than right. One of those is this: I must have done something wrong to deserve this to happen to me. The people of Israel here, where God wanted them to be, they were there as a result of faithfully following God. And yet they're in difficulties. And God allows those difficulties to come our way. For them, this is their faith being formed. And for us as well, the difficulties that come our way are sometimes it's our faith being formed as we live in a broken world. So it's not, I must have done something wrong. That's just opening up, condemnation and all that sort of stuff. The second thing that I hear from Christians, which also most of the time is not true, when they're facing difficulties, Satan's attacking me. Well, sometimes Satan does have a go at us, and I don't want to write that off altogether. But often what I hear from people when I hear that, it's more about actually someone's pride. It sometimes is more about somebody wanting to say, actually, I'm so important that Satan is focusing all this stuff on me. Now, hear me carefully. Sometimes Satan does attack us, okay? I'm not saying he doesn't. But often when I hear that in a pastoral context, this is just a part of ordinary life, you know. The gas board have got my bill wrong. Satan must be having a go at me. I can use that because no one said that to me recently. But I have had it had said to me in the past. Maybe it's just the gas board have got the bill wrong. And maybe you should be trusting God for his daily provision. This isn't some great spiritual conspiracy that Satan has put together to make your life difficult. Question why? So let's draw together some things we've learnt this morning, and then there's something else unusually today I want to say after we've answered this question, because I want us to finish in the New Testament today, which we don't often do when we're looking at the Old, but I want to do that today. So what are the key things that we take away from this passage? We've looked at the provision of water, the bitterness becoming sweet. We look mainly at the provision of the bread, though the quails are there as well. What do we take from this stuff, this passage this morning? What do we take into this week? Dorothy.
No matter what situation we find ourselves in, God will see us through.
Whatever situation we find ourselves in, God will see us through. Thank you, Mary.
And God's provision beforehand, he puts it in place before the need arises, so it's not a shock to him.
Yeah. God never gets surprised. You know, when we have some need or thing come our way, you know, God knows it's going to happen, and the provision is there. The provision is there beforehand. Steve.
We don't need to be anxious about anything because God's got it under control.
We don't need to be anxious about anything because God's got it under control.
Yeah, we have to be, you know, we have to tune our heart to God, even in the midst of trouble when we're going through bitter things. Because even in the midst of the bitterness, God might be speaking to us. He might be giving us direction on specific things to do. Like he told Moses that he should cut the tree and throw it in the water. In the midst of bitterness, God indeed do give us instructions, strategies.
Very good. So in the middle of the bitterness, we need to be listening to God and allowing God to speak to us. Yeah, very good.
The lesson you can learn from it is that after a period of difficulty in our lives, there is a period of peace.
Mm-hmm. After a period of difficulty, there is a period of peace, yeah. Finally, Christine.
Yes, and God does listen to our cries and concerns, and we don't have to be perfect for him to actually...
Yeah, God listens, that's very important. God listens to our cries and our concerns. We don't have to be perfect to hear from God, for him to answer. I want you to turn with me to John chapter 6, and this is where we're going to finish. This is Jesus teaching, and we're just going to read about 12 verses from this chapter. You see, because I'm conscious this morning that some of you who are here today, you may not know Jesus actually personally in your life. You may know about him. You're here this morning maybe because you're interested, maybe because you've come for the dedication. Maybe you're just a visitor that's walked in off the street, but you don't actually know Jesus. You don't have that personal relationship with him and with God. And so I want to just look at how Jesus took this story from the Old Testament and applied it to himself and make a comment about how it applies to us here this morning. Do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. On him, the God the Father has placed his seal of approval. Then they asked him, what must we do the work that God requires? Jesus answered, the work of God is this, to believe in the one he has sent. So they asked him, what miraculous sign will you give us that we may see it and believe you? What will you do? Our forefathers ate the manna in the desert, as it's written. He gave them bread from heaven to eat. Jesus said to them, I tell you the truth. It is not Moses who's given you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Sir, they said, from now on give us this bread. down to verse 35. Jesus declared, "I am the bread of life. Who comes to me will never go hungry. Who believes in me will never be thirsty." Down to verse 47. "I tell you the truth, he who believes has everlasting life. I am the bread of life. Your forefathers ate the manna in the desert, yet they died. But here is bread that comes down from heaven, which a man may eat and not die. I am the living bread that comes down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I give for the life of the world." Jesus has come into our world. And as Fiona was talking earlier on, he died on the cross, a bitter death, so that we may know sweetness in life. And he is, in the Old Testament, the people ate the manna day by day. But for us, the provision is there in Jesus. And he promises for us, if we believe in him, if we trust him, he will be that provision for us of daily bread. And in your life, if you're walking at the moment in life and you don't have relationship with God, you've heard Chantel and Mason talk about that. You've heard me and heard others. But you think, actually, I know about God, but I don't know God. I don't know God working in my life. I don't hear God speaking to me. I'm not going to hear God say to me, "Here is this provision I put over here," because I don't know God. This morning, after we finished our meeting this morning, I want to invite you to find one of the people that you know here or one of those you've seen at the front and ask them to tell you more about how you today can find Jesus in your life. Let's stand together. Let me pray for you as we finish this morning. And after we finish praying here, Timmy and Warren, will you come and pray for Caleb? That word I had for Caleb earlier on. If you come and do that after we finish praying, thank you very much. Let's just still our minds before God. Allow God to speak to us. If there is a situation in your life where you need God's provision, maybe you are in a bitter place, there are bitter circumstances in your life. Maybe it's just that you feel you don't have that daily provision from God. I want you just in your own minds, not out loud, just in your own minds, just to lift that up now before God. Bring that bitter situation. Bring that situation of need before God. Father God, you know all things. You know everything there is in us and about us. You know and you understand. And you see what is in our minds. You know the needs that is there, the things we're lifting before you at the moment, the bitter places that need to be made sweet, the situations that need your provision. And as we lift them before you this morning, Father God, I thank you that you are faithful and you provide what we need. I thank you that you are bringing sweetness and you're going to bring sweetness into those bitter situations and you're going to turn them around and bring sweetness and life and light in there. And I thank you, Father God, that in these situations of need that are being lifted up, you are the daily bread. You are going to provide everything that is needed. You're going to provide that in those situations. And I thank you, Father, that you do that. You do meet our needs. You do provide for us. And so we commit this week to you. We commit this week to you. Father, we want to claim that we're going to see your daily provision for us in every situation that we face, in every difficulty that we face, at work, at home, at college, with our friends, with our neighbours, with our enemies, wherever we are, whatever situation, I want to pray that we will see your daily provision for us this week, your daily bread provided for us in every context, in every place, in the name of Jesus. Amen. God bless you. Please sit down.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our postcode is UB69UA. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034 and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.